Ladies and gentlemen, seekers of light and secret knowledge wherever you may be, you are listening to Points of Light Radio, the podcast dedicated to taking you past the apron and behind the closed doors of lodges everywhere. And here is your host, Stan Miller.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. Shalom, assalamu alaikum. As I always say, it's wonderful to be back with you here on Points of Light Radio and fellowshipping with you and my guests. I don't know about you, but I feel privileged as I sit here and go down along this journey of learning as our guests shed light on these different various storied organizations. Right? I don't know whether you feel privileged, but I do, sitting here, right, just having these conversations. And here on Points of Light Radio, we will continue our journey by shedding some light on the Native Sons of the Golden West, right? And I want to take this opportunity to actually compliment the Native Sons of the Golden West. I reached out to them and they replied to me within days, not even 24 hours, actually. They were back to me, and within days, this interview was set up. Right. And that kind of reason I'm saying that, I'll admit it. Many of the other organizations I've tried to interview, they either don't get back to me or they get back to me later on or like quite late, or they get back to me and start some planning. And then next thing you know, the whole idea dies on the vine for them and they never get back to me again. So I do appreciate the Native Sons of the Golden West. They did. This interview was set up within days of my reaching out to them, and I do appreciate that, right? But back to the organization itself, to give you some insight, Native Sons of the Golden West is a fraternal service organization that was founded, according to records, on the 11th of July, 1875, by General A.M. Wynn. He was a Virginian who had moved to California. The organization was designed as a lasting monument to the men and women of the Gold Rush era of the 1840s. Native Sons of the Golden West are dedicated to historic preservation, documentation of historic structures and places in the state of California. Native Sons of the Golden West meet in lodges known as parlors. Right? Now, I will let my guest shed further light on what I've already told you about them, as well as some other aspects of the Native Sons of the Golden West. And to do that, we'll be fellowshipping with Eric Christensen. Mr. Christensen is the past grand president of the Native Sons of the Golden West. He's also president of the Native Sons of the Golden West Excelsior No. 31 Parlor. Let's go have Mr. Christensen shed light on this organization. Are you still searching for the light? Are you still hungry for knowledge? Then just trim your lamp and follow me. Eric Christensen.
Mr. Miller, how are you, sir?
Welcome to Points of Light Radio.
Thank you.
Well, you are the past grand president of the Native Sons of the Golden West and current president of the Excelsior Parlor number 31. Now, why don't you tell my listeners and viewers about yourself?
Well, about myself, I'm, as you said, a past grand president. I've been the grand historian twice for the order, and I've risen through the chairs of our local parlor over the course of about 20 years.
Okay. And so you've been involved with the Native Sons of the Golden West for around 20 years.
Yes, I when we moved back from a large city in California to back to a rural area where I grew up, I went to a meeting and met a lot of like-minded fellows and knew a lot of people, and it was just a really good fit for me. So I joined about 20 years ago.
Now, you mentioned you were a grand historian. What exactly does a grand historian do?
So in our order, we're a fraternal organization dedicated to the preservation of California history. And so the Grand Historian basically documents the Grand Presidency of whoever is the Grand President of that particular year, what they did, important events, dedications of historical sites and things like that, and then presents that report and puts those documents in the archives.
Okay, well, now, in regards to the Native Sons of the Golden West, what are the qualifications to join?
So you have to be a native-born Californian. We have two exceptions for that. One is if your parents were in military service and you would have been born in California, but for the military service. And then the other is if the place in which you reside in California doesn't have a hospital, which there are some rural communities that don't, and you were born across state lines, you could still join in those two exceptions. You have to be recommended by three brothers, and you have to believe in a supreme being. And that's basically the criteria.
Okay. Now, you don't allow, you don't have mixed parlors, I guess. So there's no women in your parlors?
We absolutely do. We've allowed women in the order since around the mid-1980s.
Okay.
Prior to that, it was strictly a men's organization, but we have allowed women in for over 40 years, or about 40 years.
So what exactly does the Native Sons of the Golden West do? What exactly? You have charities, things like charity events, things like that?
You know, it's evolved over time. So going back to our founding, which would have been July 11th, 1875, at that time, they were founded to preserve the spirit of 49, which is the gold rush. And it's interesting to think that in 1875, the gold rush of 1849 was already, was leaving people's minds. They were losing interest in the historic events that had happened when the world rushed into California. And so that's what it was originally founded for, was to preserve the spirit of 49. Originally, actually, it was only open to people born west of the Sierras, and then it evolved over time to California. As time went on, not only was it the spirit of 49 that the Native Sons were interested in preserving, they wanted to preserve all of California history from 1849 forward, and in sometimes even predating 1849 when it was still territory of Mexico. And we just dedicated a historical site for one of the original land grants when it was still Alta California. And so that was what we evolved into, was doing historic preservation. We bought a famous site called Sutter's Fort. We restored it. We gave it back to the state after we had fixed it up. We've preserved California missions from the original mission system from St. Junipero Serra when he first came in. And then we, around the 1930s, 40s, we created an orphanage with the Native Daughters of the Golden West and ran that for many years until the state of California outlawed private orphanages. So then we took that charity and we began giving money to children with craniofacial anomalies, cleft palates, cleft lips. And since that was founded in the 50s, we've given over $10 million to three different hospitals in the state of California. And then most recently, we've created another foundation called the Historic Preservation Foundation, which gives money for the preservation of historic sites throughout the state.
Okay, that's interesting. Now, you did mention the days of 49 were essentially the gold rush, right? You're trying to. So, how did you go about preserving them again? Did you?
So you know,
the mines open or something, or?
We actually, the Native Sons does have a mining claim that we provide to our members currently. It's not historic, but we do have a mining claim. But, you know, it, as I said, it's varied over time what site we preserved. I mean, we preserved an old Wells Fargo Bank building that dated from 1851, really when the banks really started coming in. We've preserved Fort Gunnybags in San Francisco, which was a historic site. From around the gold rush time. We preserved the we actually purchased Coloma State Historic Park before it was a state historic park. We had the discoverer of gold, James Marshall. We took and had his body interred on the property where he discovered gold, and then we turned that over to the state. So those are some of the gold rush ones that we have done.
Okay. Now, does the Native Sons of the Golden West have a degree system?
No, we do not. In the early 1900s, late 1800s, there was a degree system, but that was eliminated.
Okay.
So we're not like many other fraternal organizations. We're a little more like the Masonic Order of Athelstan. I heard you interview that is dedicated to, looking at the history of their organization. We also look internal to our history. That's the grand historian job, but we also look external to California history as well. We've done over 1,500 plaque markers throughout the state to recognize sites of historic importance. So when someone goes to visit a town in California or a site in California, there's a little history lesson there for them on that plaque.
Now, are there any parlors outside of California or any plans to maybe put some parlors in outside of California?
No, there never will be. There was at one time the city of Tombstone, Arizona, actually asked to create a parlor of native-born Californians that had relocated there for their silver rush, and they were denied. There were other Native Son orders not related to us, but the Native Sons of Oregon, which is long since defunct, but we helped them create their ritual. The Native Sons of Michigan, we helped them establish themselves. The Native Sons of Hawaii, which I believe still exists, we helped them, but they were in no way related. It's like Oddfellows and Masons. A lot of similarities, but we're two completely different organizations.
Okay. Well, now tell us about your parlor, parlor number 31. Like, where is it located, and what is the makeup of it? Young, old, like men, women?
Yeah, so, we had, at one point we've had, parlor numbers going up into the 300s, if that gives you an idea. We probably have about 70 active parlors still in the state, which is the only place they can exist. But Excelsior 31, we're the 31st parlor created, 1880s. So not long after the founding of the order itself, there was a real big rush and they got a lot of parlors in. And our makeup is, we're in a rural community, so the rural community parlors tend to have a much more diverse makeup. We have members, my son is a member, he's 18 years old, and we have members all the way up into their 80s. But I would say the general mix is, a good chunk in their 30s to 50s and a good chunk in their 50s to 80s, and then with the outliers.
So it's in Jackson. Whereabouts is Jackson?
Jackson, California is a historic gold rush town, and it's about an hour, 45 minutes from the state capital in the foothills of the Sierra Mountains. It's a beautiful little gold rush town. Everything up and down the corridor of Highway 49 is gold rush towns, and there's a lot of Native Sons parlors up and down that corridor. From Murphy's, California, Chispa 139, we have Amador Parlor in Sutter Creek, Amador 17, all the way north. We just started a new parlor last year in Yuba City, rechartered a parlor with the old number, which was great. So, the rural communities, the foothill communities are very, very strong for the Native Sons, and their general age mix is pretty similar to ours. It's pretty good representation all the way across the board. It's not really a really old organization along the foothills. If you get into the big cities, the parlors their demographic tends to definitely swing more towards the 60s and older.
Wow. And now give me some of the rules of the parlor. What would be rules? How would you dress, shall we say? What is the decorum?
I did enjoy
talking politics, that type of thing. Is there any?
Yeah, no, I did enjoy the discussion with Mr. Snowden and having to wear his particular tie. I thought that was interesting, and I was thinking, wow, this will be a very different conversation with Mr. Miller. We're very casual for our regular meetings, but when we do our public dedications, we either have a uniform that we wear, Native Sun shirts, and attire is set by the Grand President for that particular dedication, or we wear business suits for dedications. When we have our annual convention, all of the Grand Officers do wear business attire for the conducting of the statewide business.
So, but as far as the lodge itself, decorum?
It's very casual. It's very casual.
Okay, no, but I mean, I would say, what would you say, no talking politics in the lodge or the parlor?
We're an apolitical organization. So during the meeting, there's definitely no talk of anything other than business. Before the meeting, we usually have a social hour before the meeting. We have the meeting for about an hour, and then we have dinner. This is how our parlor runs. Most parlors are similar to that. But I guarantee you politics is discussed in a social hour and at dinner.
Yeah, we have, California.
We're in California. I will say that in our parlor, the county I live in, almost every county supervisor is a Native Son. The sheriff is a Native Son. All the way to judges. We haven't had a lot of famous, politician members, because you have to be born in California. So we have one president, which is the only one ever born in California, Richard Nixon. I don't know if that's a good or bad thing.
Okay.
Chief Justice Earl Warren, who was the governor of California, he was a member, and a couple senators, U.S. senators as well.
So Nixon was a Native Son?
Yes.
No way. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Okay. From the Southern California parlor.
Okay.
We dedicated his library a few years ago.
Well, and getting back to the meetings, so how long are your meetings on average? About an hour?
It depends on the president and how well he runs the meeting. Okay. I try to keep mine between half an hour. Since there's no ritual, it's really just conducting the business of the parlor.
Yeah.
To which charity are we going to give money, or which highway are we going to clean up, or when's our Christmas party, or what does the state need, and electing delegates and things like that. So, half an hour to an hour. I've seen them go longer, but in my parlor, it's rare. I know some other parlors, it's common to go beyond an hour.
Wow. And what effect did COVID have on the Native Sons of the Golden West?
As I was alluding to earlier, in the cities, our demographic swung much older. So we had a really large loss of our brothers due to COVID that died. And that was really unfortunate. I'll tell you an anecdotal story just from our parlor's perspective. We know everybody. We have a couple hundred members, and you see someone socially, you see them at the store. And I was at the store during COVID, and I actually had one of my elderly members who basically told me that the lack of the social interaction of Native Sons was his only thing he had, and he was now a shut-in because of COVID. And so I decided, I was president for our parlor, I decided that we were going to have socials, no meeting, but socials for those that wanted to come. So it's not a meeting, no obligation. We provided all the drinks and food free of charge for the first year. We waived dues for that year of COVID. We came out of it a lot stronger compared to a lot of other parlors that really suffered, and we're seeing closures of those parlors that stopped for 2 years. And so I think it was important for us to do one. I feel like I did something great for my brothers, giving them that social aspect. And we're in a rural community. People live, isolated, remote roads, and don't have a lot of neighbors. So I thought we did something really good for them. So we started having our mini socials probably around June after everything shut down in March. So we were only down for a couple months. So statewide, it had a bad impact. Locally, it actually had a good impact for us.
Okay. Now, what are you most proud of your time in the Native Sons of the Golden West?
That's a really good question. Before myself and another past Grand President, James King, when we were coming up through the ranks of the Grand Office, we really found that Native Sons were great at preserving California history, really good at it. We're terrible at preserving our own history. We didn't have good, we had a lot of records, but no one knew where they were. No one knew what they said. And so around 2015, he and I embarked on a project to basically document our history from fraternal record magazines, from newspaper clippings, from our own internal documents, really building what's the history. And we uncovered a lot of things that were just unknown about the order. And that's ongoing to this day. He and I are working on building a book ultimately, just a book about Native Sons for Native Sons, with a really in-depth look at a lot of things. And we uncovered some really amazing things. As I said, we have 1,500 plaques, but there's only three plaques that aren't in California. No one knew we had three plaques that weren't in California. There's one at the Archivo de Indias in Barcelona, Spain. There's one at Pearl Harbor, and there's one at Arlington National Cemetery in Washington, D.C. And I visited two of those three sites, and I'm sending my daughters to visit the third one since I'm not going to Hawaii with them. So that's probably what I'm most proud of is doing that.
And what do you feel it's done for you, your membership in the Native Sons of the Golden West? What do you think it's done for you?
You know, I think it's definitely deepened and broadened my knowledge of California history. As a grand officer, you travel all over the state. I have seen parts of the state, and I'm, you know, sixth generation Californian that I never even knew existed. And to go on just some obscure little places that you didn't know was a historic anything, and just to stop along the side of a road and say, I know what's here. And I think for me, it's really just really strengthened my love of history, preserving history, those sorts of things. It's also, you know, I've made lifelong friends. We just took a trip of eight of us to Kentucky for bourbon tasting with Native Sons. Just you make buddies and lifelong buddies. I mean, one of the past Grand President King, he comes to Thanksgiving in my house. He comes to Christmas in my house, and he's 6 hours away. And but you know, and I go see him. I'll probably see him this coming weekend. So it's really just it's been pretty amazing thing. I'm a very introverted person. I don't like public speaking. I'm not bad at it, but I don't like it. And getting up at the convention and being the CEO of the corporation, the grand president, and talking to 400 of your best friends, it really made it a lot of fun, and you know, makes it a lot easier to get out and talk and do those sorts of things.
You feel it. What do you feel it could do for others?
You know, I think it depends on what you want to get out of it. What you put into it is what you're going to get out of it. The incoming grand president that's going to be coming in here in May, he really wants to focus on family, and he really wants to make a lot of family events. And I think that's great. And I think that's what he wants to get out of it, and that's what he wants to bring to the order. You're going to make amazing friendships. You're going to have some of the best meals you've ever had. You get to travel all over the state and instantly have a family or a friend that's a Native Son, which is fantastic. I can go to the northmost corner of the state and the southmost corner of the state, which California is, you know, 16 hours apart.
Yeah.
And I have an instant family there, people I can stay with, people I can have dinner with, people we can have a cocktail with, people that can show me around, show me a bit of history I hadn't seen in those areas. And it's just, I think that's, again, what you put in. So if you want to do charitable, we have a brother in Elk Grove Parlor who has a cleft lip, and his passion is for our charitable foundation, for what they do for children with craniofacial anomalies. That's what got him really gung-ho about it. And he's one of our most excited members. He's doing a lot. He's hard charging. So for him, that's his motivation. And so Native Sons offers such a broad array of things. We own a lake in the High Sierra. Some members just join just so they can go camp at, you know, the lake that we own. So it's
free of charge. They can go free of charge.
Absolutely. Except for in the winter, because you can't get up there because there's about 20 feet of snow.
Oh, absolutely. But still, that's amazing. Wow. Yeah,
we offer a lot. Just what you want to get out of it is what you're going to get out of it. Cause there's a lot we offer.
Well, Mr. Christensen, I appreciate your time tonight, and all the best to you and your parlor there.
Oh, absolutely. If you ever have any more questions, feel free to hit me up. You're doing a great show, and I've been enjoying it on my car ride every day.
Thank you, sir. Bye-bye. Dear Christensen, brothers and sisters, Wasn't that interesting learning about them? Had you ever heard about the Native Sons of the Golden West before? Well, now you have, right? Some personal observations of mine. You have to be born in California, with a few exceptions here and there, to be part of the Native Sons of the Golden West. And that's because, and that's quite unique. And the reason for it is also unique because they are a California-based organization. They're not statewide, right? California. Not nationwide, not international. Absolutely no parlors outside of the state of California. That's very unique, as I said, to many of the other organizations that I've covered here on Points of Light Radio, right? But some big takeaways here. COVID hurt the Native Sons of the Golden West as an organization, but Mr. Christensen's parlor thrived because of the activities that he did. And if you notice, many of the other organizations I've covered, like, for instance, the Free Gardeners and such, have thrived during COVID, right? Now, I've said before, I've looked for ways that they've done this. Well, this is one of the ways that it was done. This gentleman took it upon himself to make sure that the membership stayed connected through these socials that he organized. I love that. Provided everything. And that really goes to show you this can be done. It really can be, right? And the Native Sons of the Golden West, he said, were great at preserving California history, but not the history of their organization. And he is determined to, and he has been addressing that issue, right? And I've said this before here on Points of Light Radio. This is another organization that lines up with mine, and his goals are pretty much the same as mine, to preserve the history, right, and raise the profile of these different fraternal organizations, right? I love how he's going about doing that. Right? These organizations are worth preserving and their history is worth remembering, right? Right. And Richard Nixon, Tricky Dick Nixon, was a Native Son of the Golden West. Well, wow. I didn't know that. That's news, right? Right. But The other big thing is that Mr. Christensen mentioned here, is that you get out of the Native Sons of the Golden West what you put into your time there. And that's very true. If you look at it and it lines up, you're hearing this reoccurring theme as we go along in our journey here from the different fraternal organizations. You get out of it what you put into it. If you just want to show up and attend your meetings, you can do that. But the people who really thrive and really get the most out of these organizations are the ones that go in there and they serve on committees and they take office within the lodge, things like that, or the parlors in this case. That's very important. That's a very important element of it, right? And it's worth noting, before you join anything, look at what you could give to it and as well as get out of it, right? But I'm afraid I've given as much as I am for this particular segment of Points of Light Radio. I'm going to have to part with you. But before I go, I want to remind you that this podcast is available on both YouTube and Spreaker. Please share, like, and subscribe when viewing Points of Light Radio on YouTube. And I also welcome, and I want to see your comments and input. I've got some of the same people putting comments and input into my on my YouTube videos there. I want to see more of you putting your comments and input in here, right? And I also want you to spread the word about Points of Light Radio. You can follow Points of Light Radio on my Facebook page at facebook.com/Points of Light Radio. My Twitter handle is at PO Light Radio. You can see the link to my Spotify channel as well as my Points of Light Radio store, where you can go and purchase some Points of Light Radio merchandise. as well as other fraternal merchandise. I also want to point out that Points of Light Radio is available to advertise your fraternal store or event. Just get in touch with me via my Facebook page. But as I always say, brothers and sisters, I'm sorry to part with you, but until we meet again, just step into the light.